Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is Delving Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture, and hopefully the most Renaissance man-like manner in which arts and culture may be discussed. So please stay tuned for that. Now, it just happened that earlier today I saw a video somewhere in the front page of my YouTube's, I guess, recommendation stream that it was something like every best picture Oscar winner in the history of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences in their, is it 90-year history? I can't remember how many they have. But anyway, so I didn't click on that video because I'm already rather familiar with the not terribly glamorous list of best picture winners, as I'm sure every film buff who has watched movies for some matter of decades, whether one or two or however many, like even people who are casual film buffs, I'm sure have a set amount of familiarity with Oscars. But anyway, seeing that rather basic, I guess it's some sort of a clip show, PowerPoint presentation type video about the Oscar winners from the first one, which is Wings from 1920-something, and the last one of Green Book from this present year. Seeing that video inspired me to make this video, which is what, in the split second where I saw that video on the front page of my YouTube, I thought that it was somebody ranking Best Picture Oscar winners from best to worst. I wouldn't have checked that video out either, but the momentary assumption that somebody had made a video like that inspired me to make this video. Now, I don't particularly care to put my own cinematic taste as it regards the Oscar Academy, but because I'm frequently, like, if I would mention the Oscars, I would probably mention them in a somewhat dismissive light, in that there's a British film critic called Kim Newman, who on one hand he writes to a magazine like Sight and Sound, and on the other hand he reviews rather schlocky genre films for some more mainstream publications at times, like Empire. But anyway, Kim Newman has this quotation where he says that he can always predict which movie will win the best picture, because he always picks the movie that out of all the nominees that he has the least interest in seeing, and he thinks that that's the overwhelming favorite to actually win the award. And when you look at this list of winners, there are some rather eyebrow-raising choices. Now, I don't want to go through all the usual suspects as to why did How Green Was My Valley win over Maltese Falcon and Citizen Kane. Well, I believe that Maltese Falcon and Citizen Kane probably were both of those debut feature films from Orson Welles and John Huston. I think they were, whereas John Ford was just about the most well-established director in Hollywood history. So, you know, that was a case of a director potentially seen as duo winning over a couple of rookies. Now, obviously, things like that are, you know, very famous examples that we all think that, hey, why didn't a bigger classic win over a film that's barely a classic? You know, we all know those types of situations. We don't need to go over those. I think, you know, I don't want to say so sweepingly that the wrong film would always win, or that some sort of a bland film would always win, because there are some high quality winners, but you know, if the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences theoretically has the peak over all of the greatest films of all time, it's shocking when I actually ranked these films from my biggest favorite to my least favorite. It's shocking how few genuinely, definitive, greatest masterpieces of all time type movies there are in the Best Picture winners. So by my counting, there are six Oscar winners that I would consider part of the very inner core of the biggest masterpieces ever. Like, just six. If there is like something like 90 years of Oscars, just six huge classics. That batting average is so below the Mendoza line, if you'll pardon a baseball analogy, that it is genuinely shocking. Now, some of those other films, they're all right. But like, considering just how regularly the Oscars seem to get this wrong, it is impressive that people still pay attention to the Oscars. Now, again, I don't want to take easy shots at the Oscars for not having the foresight of thinking that some particular film would be a bit of a sleeper hit and that it would gain reputation slowly over the years, such as Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo, which was nowhere near the classic when it was released as it is now, set on other Hitchcock movies fall in that line. But like things like Charlie Chaplin movies never winning Best Picture, I mean, it just makes the silent film selection just look comically bad. All right. Now, since I mentioned silent film classics, I will mention that Wings indeed was the first film that I chose as an official Best Picture winner, because F.W. Murnau's Sunrise, A Song of Two Humans, I believe it won some sort of an award. But I didn't. I used the Wikipedia entries reference list, so Wings was the first one there. And so I don't actually know what the status of Sunrise is. I know that it won some award, but anyway, I'll just mention that in passing. And again, I'll reiterate that the main reason why I'm doing this video is because in other film-related videos, I'm liable to mention that I don't take the Oscars that seriously, and the paucity of huge classics when ranked from best to worst, just according to my tastes. This video is meant to demonstrate why it is that I don't take Oscars that seriously. Now, again, something that you could say is that if I rank the films that won Best Director, that list of films would look a lot better than the Best Picture list. Well, we're going with the biggest category because that's what the Oscar. I mean, this is the aesthetic line that the Oscars is putting forward, and I'm just showing what my relation to it. I'll say one more thing before going to the final list, is that how I rank these, because it's very difficult to compare drastically different kinds of movies, is that I rank these using the kind of criteria that if there was randomly chosen moment in my life, how liable would I be to want to rewatch something? So you might think that that's kind of a quirky way of ordering this list, but I generally feel like rewatchability is kind of the moment of truth for movies, because If you say that a given movie is great, but you never feel like rewatching it, like how great can it be if you never wanna rewatch it? So that's basically the kind of standard that I use. And basically, I don't want to answer questions. Like I'm more than happy to talk about any of these selections if some viewer would want it in the comments. But basically, I don't want to answer questions in the main as to why a given film that you think should be a top 10 classic, why it's way outside the top 10. I'll just say in general, in case some people think that some film is accidentally too low, in that some of these selections can be that, let's say that between five films. Let's say that the margin of error tends to be around five films. So a given film might be five films higher, five films lower, depending on if I did this list yesterday, if I did it tomorrow, it would be slightly different. But I won't admit that the margin of error is more than five positions, you know, plus minus. Usually if a film is, if some of you consider that a film is too low, the most likely case is that I think that a film has one persisting flaw to it, somehow tonally, that keeps annoying me. Or alternatively, I just think that a film is merely slight. Now, as I already said, I think that the really elite category is only six films. So from one to six, I think those are the most elite Best Picture winners. Now, I think that the second tier could conceivably go from something like number seven to, let's say, number seven to number 35. I think those are all solid winners that I don't think the Academy needs to be too worried about, although that's not to say that I don't. That I would think that those, like, just because something is high doesn't mean that I think it's the best film of that year. It's not my fault that people didn't vote for Goodfellas. If Goodfellas was a Best Picture winner, it would easily be in the top five, and so on. So, me approving a given film isn't meant as approving that it won over an even better film. So, that's that. But anyway, then from something like 36 to something like 61, I think that's already kind of a shabbier bunch, but I suppose I can halfway approve of that. But then from 61 down, those are already starting to. From 61 to 71, those are movies that I'm already not particularly high on, and then from 72 to 84, those are movies that I'm, you know, the closer it is to 84, I'm actively starting to dislike. And I'll say before I'll do the final list, is that there's one, two, three, four, five movies that I haven't seen, five Best Picture winners that I haven't seen. Green Book is the most recent. Now I'll watch it when I just happen to get it. I'm in no hurry to see it. I think it was a supremely random Best Picture winner, as have many of these, let's say, post Return of the King winners. They just seem random. Like, you will see that the recent films are really low on my list, and those just seem like such a random bunch of films, but it is what it is. But anyway, I haven't seen Green Book. I haven't seen The Great Sick Field. I haven't seen The Life of Emile Zola, at least not that I can remember. I haven't seen Chimarron, and I haven't seen The Broadway Melody. Now, I have this vague idea that I may have seen The Life of Emile Zola when I was a teenager, but because I can't remember anything about it, I cannot rank it. Like, I cannot rank it because I can't remember anything about it. But So by my counting, there's 5 films that I haven't seen. Green Book, The Great Siegfeld, The Life of Emil Sola, Chimarron and The Broadway Melody. So they aren't listed because I haven't seen them. And then there are 84 films listed. So anyway, I'll just read them from best to worst, from 1 to 84, and then I will offer some kind of commentary about some randomly chosen films as to why they are either higher or lower based on my, you know, this is just my subjective taste and so on. I just feel obligated to say it. So anyway, number one, I think the most impressive Oscar winner of all time, I have to say that I think it's Casablanca. Now, I don't know whether I should read the list and then talk about some of the entries, or I'll do that. I'll read the list first and then I'll defend some of my reasoning. So number one, Casablanca. Number two, Lawrence of Arabia. Number three, The Godfather. Number four, An American in Paris. Number five, On the Waterfront. Number six, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And I won't read the numbers, I'll just read the entries. So then 7, The Apartment. 8, Annie Hall. 9, Rocky. 10, Amadeus. Schindler's List. No Country for Old Men. All About Eve. All the King's Men. The English Patient. Titanic. Dances with Wolves. It Happened One Night. Rebecca. Gone with the Wind. Return of the King. The French Connection. Chicago. Birdman. Midnight Cowboy. My Fair Lady. The Bridge on the River Kwai. From Here to Eternity. Shakespeare in Love. Out of Africa. The Last Emperor. Gladiator. Godfather Part 2. The Best Years of Our Lives. Unforgiven. Ordinary People. American Beauty. In the Heat of the Night. Kramer vs. Kramer. The Lost Weekend. The Departed. Platoon. All Quiet on the Western Front. Braveheart. Chariots of Fire. Forrest Gump. The Silence of the Lambs. Gandhi. A Man for All Seasons. The Sound of Music. Moonlight. 12 Years a Slave. Rain Man. The Deer Hunter. The Sting. Around the World in 80 Days. Gentleman's Agreement. Ben-Hur. Marty. The King's Speech. Grand Hotel. Driving Miss Daisy. Slumdog Millionaire. Patton. Million Dollar Baby. Hamlet. The Hurt Locker. How Green Was My Valley. Terms of Endearment. The Artist. Mutiny on the Bounty. A Beautiful Mind. Going My Way. Oliver. Tom Jones. The Shape of Water. Crash. Mrs. Miniver. Gigi. Spotlight. Wings. You Can't Take It With You. Cavalcade. The Greatest Show on Earth. So anyway, I don't feel like I need to defend the top 10 positions too much, except some people think that I have, some people could conceivably think that I have Rocky too high, or perhaps this stretch of 3 films that I put outside the elite there of The Apartment, Annie Hall and Rocky. So that's 2 comedies. Rocky is a very popular movie. The problem is that I think Rocky is kind of a perfect movie as far as what it achieves to do. I think that I would liken Rocky being high on the list to An American in Paris being high on the list. I think that what to me seems like obviously the greatest moment in American in Paris is when Gene Kelly is setting up his breakfast, but he's dancing through it in an unbroken shot. No editing, just Gene Kelly setting up his breakfast like a ballet scene. To me, that seems like the only kind of moment where another artist is basically beating Charlie Chaplin at his own game. So if you think of something like the Roll Dance from the Gold Rush, I feel like Gene Kelly is reaching those types of, you know, very graceful, graceful moments that they're easy to take for granted, but when you look at how many people can actually match that kind of a tonality, like, you know, you can say that there's the old school Disney cartoons, there's Chaplin, there's Buster Keaton, maybe Gene Kelly, you know, maybe some people feel like Fellini's La Strada or something, but like very few moments throughout 100 years of cinema meets that kind of a quality of special, like doing something that's special whilst being simple. I feel like it's very easy to underrate an American in Paris, and I feel like Vincent Minnelli is one of the very greatest directors in the history of American cinema. I feel like Rocky has a lot of those kinds of moments in it where it's easy to think that something is, or it's just a training montage, or it's just, you know, Rocky talking with Adrian at the doorway or something. But like those are moments where through the most simple elements, the film manages to reach a very special, you know, tonal presence. And that's why I feel like Rocky is a very underrated movie. Now, obviously, the Rocky sequels are why some people don't take the first one that seriously. And, you know, you could say that it shouldn't have won over Taxi Driver. Again, that's not my fault. I'm not an Academy voter. But anyway, I do feel like defending Rocky. I feel like it is a very well-made movie. And the Bill Conti soundtrack to it, like, that is the heart and soul to that kind of a movie. And it absolutely does elevate it to a special position in my eyes. Now, I feel like the English Patient, Titanic, and Dances with Wolves, that's another three stretch movie where some people might raise an eyebrow as to why I have them so high. But I do greatly like that kind of an old school epic feel. You know, like, I'm personally a fan of Luchino Visconti movies and Douglas Sirk movies. So Visconti and Sirk were two early directors who, as it were, specialized in melodramas. And I believe that Visconti has a line where he is saying that he thinks that melodramas get a bad rap because melodrama is just emotions in their most extreme form. Melodrama is basically like emotions without subtlety. Now, obviously, some people can appreciate subtlety. It's fine to think that subtle emotional core is great for a movie, but then, you know, some of us like the kind of more operatic sweep to storytelling, where, you know, Titanic obviously isn't trying to be subtle. I think James Cameron at the top of his game is a fine director. I think that sometimes he makes questionable decisions as far as the screenplay is concerned, but for instance, the Billy Zane performance in Titanic, I don't think it lessens the movie. It's just how melodramas go about their business. He's, you know, mush that's twirling and whatever. But like, the English Patient, Titanic, Dances with Wolves, you know, it's not my fault if some of you don't like that some of those films won over Jerry Maguire or Good Will Hunting or Goodfellas. But anyway, like, those three epics, I think are just fine. I feel like Chicago is perhaps another movie that I need to slightly defend as to why I think it's high. I think I don't rate Rob Marshall particularly highly as a director. And I've heard theories suggesting that Bill Condon, the screenwriter, is kind of the secret MVP to Chicago as to how he married the musical set pieces and how he found a way to bridge kind of attempts at standard drama to the kind of fantasious dream sequences. I think that tonally there's a pleasing kind of underrated dexterity to Chicago, and I think it's a quality movie, and that's why it's higher on the list than not. I don't know if some people feel like The Bridge on the River Kwai is too low. If it is, I feel like there's a lot to like about that movie. I greatly appreciate David Lean as a director, as Lawrence of Arabia being, to me, the second greatest Best Picture winner of all time, maybe the greatest. I felt like I had to give Casablanca the top notch, because Casablanca in many ways is the perfect Hollywood movie. That it's everything that Hollywood wishes it was all the time. So that's why I feel like Casablanca deserves the top spot. But anyway, Bridge on the River Kwai, I feel like the only truly transcendental thing about that movie is the Alec Guinness performance. Now, it's obviously like the William Holden segments, that's fine, but like Alec Guinness is definitely the X factor in it. And I feel like he is kind of a, you know, like he's making the film more special, but I just feel like it's like how The Bridge on the River Kwai plays in my mind, that it's 70% the kind of William Holden and the standard kind of POW stuff, and then 30% the kind of more special Alec Guinness type stuff. So it's a fine film, but I don't think it's absolutely the biggest kind of masterpiece in cinema history. But anyway, so some of you, well, Shakespeare in Love at 29, some people will definitely roast me for having it higher than some classics, but Tom Stoppard is one of my very favorite modern playwrights. I feel like Tom Stoppard, he is that kind of a last in line in the, you know, British tradition of, you know, wit, whether you want to talk about Oscar Wilde or Charles Dickens or whoever you want to bring up from the kind of British storytelling tradition, in that I would put Tom Stoppard as the last of that kind of a great line. And you know, I don't know whether some of those inside jokes in Shakespeare in Love that Stoppard was putting there, whether they're landing on the audience or not, but I think Shakespeare in Love is great fun. You know, it's a movie that I always liked. Some of you don't like that it won over Saving Private Ryan. To me, that doesn't matter, because Terrence Malick had the best movie of that year anyway. But anyway, 29, Shakespeare in Love, it's a film I very much appreciate. Some people might think that I have Godfather 2 too low at number 33. You know, I like Godfather Part 2 just fine. I just think that the diptych narrative strategy, where it's jumping on timelines from the young Vito of Robert De Niro and then the Al Pacino sequel, I feel like that kind of a narrative structure is keeping me slightly at an arm's length in a manner that, you know, I thought Chinatown was the best film of that year, but we don't need to get into that. But anyway, and Chinatown certainly would be in top 5, but again, we don't need to get into that. I just think that the narrative strategy to Godfather Part 2 doesn't work the best for me. Now, number 37, I feel like some people might want me to defend this, because I remember reading a certain film blog years ago, where one of the commentators said of the article posted by the film critic, saying that, have we found the rarest of all creatures, a film critic that never disowned their initial enthusiasm for American Beauty? Now, I guess I would halfway be in that kind of a register, in that I never changed my mind about an American Beauty. I think that Sam Mendes has his moments as a director. I think that he has, his filmography has become rather questionable, in that he seems to just somehow fade into being Martin Campbell light, and he thinks that that's fine. Like, by the way, I like Martin Campbell, so I'm not saying that that's throwing shade or anything, but like, you know, Martin Campbell isn't doing Best Picture type films. So I think American Beauty was a fine film. I thought Road to Perdition, that that was a fine film from Sam Mendes. And with American Beauty, I feel like some people don't really get the satire of the screenplay. Like, either they don't get that it's a satire, or alternatively, they get it just fine. They just don't find it humorous, so that the jokes don't land with them. But anyway, like, the stuff that people parody about an American Beauty, like the edgy neighbor saying that a plastic bag blowing in the wind is the most beautiful thing he's ever seen. Like, Sam Mendes isn't suggesting, like, the film isn't trying to portray that as the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It's just different perspectives in the wacky world of suburbia. So I feel like some people don't get that the plastic bag thing, for instance, that's part of the satire. It's meant to be a joke. Like, it is Curb Your Enthusiasm or Ricky Gervais type comedy, that there's these two teenagers having some sort of a, you know, middle class moment of aesthetics. You know, like, things like that. I mean, to me, the Comedy of Manners level to American Beauty, it works pretty fine. Sam Mendes, again, as I said, has his moments as a director. Now, some people will definitely think that I have The Departed too low at 41. The problem is that I consider it a rather flawed remake of a superior foreign film. And so, you know, had Infernal Affairs from Hong Kong won Best Picture, I would have it way higher. I just think that The Departed is tonally a bit all over the place. And I think that some of the casting is not quite as great as people like to make it out to be. But anyway, I might do a full review of The Departed if some folks want me to go more in detail as to what I think all the problems are. I think it's, you know, not the best idea that that's the only Martin Scorsese Best Picture winner, because it's like his 17th best movie or something. I'm actually serious. I think that Martin Scorsese has something like 16 better films. But yeah, Departed at 41, still closer to the top than the bottom. Some younger film buffs won't like that I have Forrest Gump and The Silence of the Lambs at the lower half of the list. The problem is that I think that Forrest Gump is... the production values are fine. The performances are fine. The soundtrack, all of that is fine. It's a film that seems to try to have some sort of a masterpiece of shallowness, in that, you know, most of drama comes when the main character has to encounter things that they don't want to encounter, and then we discover more complex emotions as the main character has to wrestle with the difficulties or whatever. But like, Forrest Gump has the narrative depth of a Super Mario side-scroller adventure, where it's just some sort of a, you know, montage of nostalgia over Americana and whatever. So, like, to me, Forrest Gump is like a music video. And you know, the production values are just top notch, but like you need something more, really. And then The Silence of the Lambs, I actually just recently rewatched it. I was never as big a fan of Jonathan Demme as, say, some people like Richard Linklater or Paul Thomas Anderson, who they had a lot of love for Demme. You know, I don't know. Like, some of the performances, like, to me, Silence of the Lambs, like, it's a set-piece movie. Like, what people appreciate is a couple of the iconic set-pieces, but I guess I'm not enough into genre cinema to have it higher. I don't know, like, The Deer Hunter at number 54, like, some people could conceivably think that that's way too low. I know that lots of people would have it in the top 10. It's just that, for me, it's a film where the pacing really isn't optimal. And it's a film where I feel like there's too much Robert De Niro. Like, if I said of The Bridge on the River Kwai that there isn't enough Alec Guinness in it for me to have it higher. Like, you know, there's another POW film called King Rat. Was the director Bill Forsyth or something? Tom Courtney, a British actor, is in the lead. And I honestly don't think that Bridge on the River Kwai is that much better than King Rat. And, you know, there are other Vietnam War era movies, like The Deer Hunter, where I generally don't, like, there's too much Robert De Niro and not enough, like, Christopher Walken or the other characters. So I feel like, like, to me, The Deer Hunter is like the anti-Silence of the Lambs, is that Silence of the Lambs is highly regarded because of the set pieces, and it's a film almost entirely consisting of the set pieces. To me, like, Deer Hunter doesn't have enough of the set pieces, and it's just kind of lost in the interludes where people are meditating away between the set pieces. Like, I understand that I'm in the minority when it comes to it, but I don't think Deer Hunter is Michael Cimino's best movie, for whatever that's worth, and it's just, you know, it's not really for me. Like, some people might think that I have Around the World in 80 Days too high. Now, to me, it's actually a somewhat comparable film to Forrest Gump, except that, like, it is kind of a montage, clip showy, cameo heavy. But, you know, I think that it's a lightly likable movie. I don't have a problem with it. I don't think it's one of the worst Oscar movies, because it's a more likable film than these other duds at the end of the list. I don't know which, like, some people could conceivably think, yeah, I don't know which of these, like, are any of you gonna defend Patton or Laurence Olivier's Hamlet or Mutiny on the Bounty? Like, I just think that they're, like, that's the epitome of all sort of movies. Like, Patton, you know, Francis Ford Coppola wrote the screenplay. I think he may have won an Oscar for it. Patton has some quality moments. George C. Scott is fine in the lead. I just never really think that much about that movie. So, like, I guess it could be a bit higher. Like, in the higher 50s rather than at number 64, but I don't know why I would jump over some of the films. Like, I'm starting to have supreme indifference towards a lot of these movies. Now, then we get to these modern movies. Million Dollar Baby at 65, Hurt Locker at 67, Slumdog Millionaire at 63, The King's Speech at 60, The Artist at number 70, A Beautiful Mind at 72. None of these modern movies really mean anything to me. Then 73, Going My Way, the Bing Crosby movie. I probably should have had it a bit higher. You know, that's just kind of a meh movie. So, you know, maybe it should have been a bit higher because I found it lightly likable, but that's about the best that I can say. Oliver by Carol Reed. You know, it's tragic that Carol Reed... Carol Reed, who has masterpieces like The Third Man and Odd Man Out, that, you know, Carol Reed one with something like Oliver. Like, there was this vogue for the big production musical, like The Sound of Music, West Side Story, and so on in that 60s era. Oliver, it's not good. Tom Jones, some people don't understand why I have it so low. I actually love the Henry Fielding novel. Like, if I said that Tom Stoppard is, like, in the line of British wit, Henry Fielding is all but the grandfather of that tradition. I love Tom Jones, the novel. I just don't like a bad film adaptation of it, which, you know, like... That Tom Jones, it reminds me of late period Fellini. Like, you know, I understand why some people like it. It's just not for me. And then Mrs. Miniver and Gigi, two old films that I really don't like. You know, Mrs. Miniver, I understand why they made it during World War II. You know, it's something for the home front and... keeping the morale and whatever, but it's not a movie that ages great. Like, Mrs. Miniver is why I understand why some people don't like melodramas. And Gigi, even though I talked up Vincent Minnelli in the American in Paris, Gigi, it's not a good movie. It's just, at least I don't like it. You know... Cecil B. DeMille's The Greatest Show on Earth is the lowest film on my list. Cavalcade is the second lowest. Cavalcade, I think, is merely thoroughly boring. Greatest Show on Earth, it's actually a film that I'm... Like, I literally cannot understand how anyone could have thought that that was special. Like, maybe there's some exoticism... And maybe some people like some of the production values, but like The Greatest Show on Earth to me is officially the most baffling Best Picture winner. Because like it's the only one of these where I literally cannot understand anyone who put it in there. Like unless it was devotion to DeMille, who had some quality moments like you know, DeMille's Cleopatra, Ten Commandments, or whatever. It's like, the production values to those, they're fine. But like, Greatest Show on Earth, it's just a random. Winner, you can take it with you. I like Frank Capra, but, you know, that's not a good one in my books. And then a lot of these bad modern films, Crash, Spotlight. Like, I can't believe Spotlight won over The Revenant. Like, that's just shocking. Like, honestly, I think Spotlight winning over The Revenant, like, The Revenant would have made the top 25 with me. Like, Spotlight winning over The Revenant was more shocking than Crash winning over Brokeback Mountain. But yeah, and then some people, like, I greatly like Guillermo del Toro, but The Shape of Water, like, I couldn't believe that anyone considered that a good movie. Like, I couldn't understand it. And, you know, I may be in the minority, but I don't think Guillermo del Toro's English language forays are very good. I don't particularly like his Pacific Rim. You know, those Hellboy movies that he did, I think they are decent, but like, you know, not part of his greatness. The Crimson Peak movie had its moments. It was like kind of like an elite tribute to some Dario Argento type storytelling, but I feel like the script was one notch too insufficient. So Crimson Peak, I think, is Del Toro's best English language movie. Then, you know, he's done some films like, did Del Toro do Blade 3? and with Wesley Snipes, and did he do some sort of a mimic type movie? Like, Del Toro's English language releases, they're all pretty bad in my book. Obviously, Pan's Labyrinth is an epic masterpiece, and, you know, he has other winners in the Spanish language cinema, but yeah, Shape of Water, I couldn't understand it. But anyway, I don't know if I need to defend any of these other choices. Like, obviously, if any viewers made it this far and they want to discuss any of my selections, if they want to hear some of my thoughts as to why, you know, something like Maati was rather low on the list, or, you know, why William A. Wellman's Wings isn't higher. Well, I mean, the simple answer is that I don't think a lot of those movies. But like, should somebody want to discuss anything, you can do it in the comments. But anyway, yeah, this was my list, and these were my ideas around the Oscar track record. I don't know whether I should do some sort of a ranking of the Cannes Film Festival roster of winners, because I don't think that, like, if anything, I feel like Cannes underperforms even compared to the Oscars, where, like, Oscars have some random winners, but it's nothing compared to how Festival de Cannes has random winners. But also, Cannes has just, like, you know, I feel like my list of Oscars is rather it's rather shallow on the ends, in that I would say that A Beautiful Mind at number 72 is a movie, like I already said, that I think Going My Way should have been higher. But like, if Going My Way was 72 and A Beautiful Mind would be 73, I think as from 73 to 84, to me those are borderline bad movies. And then only from number 1 to number 6, those are like really top tier masterpieces. But anyway, like, that would leave a lot of stuff to the middle, whereas I think that the Cannes Film Festival, like, that roster of winners has more top-tier movies, but also more just, like, bewildering misses. Anyway, I don't know whether I'll do that, or, you know, whether I'll do that or whether I won't. I don't know if I have seen a sufficient percentage of Cannes winners to do it. Like, I actually think that it's mildly impressive that I have managed to only not see 5 Best Picture winners, given how little I think of the Oscars as far as taste-making body is concerned. So, you know, there's way more than 5 Cannes winners that I must have missed, especially from recent years, where they've, again, gone even worse with the winners than Oscars have. But I'll consider that. Maybe I will, maybe I won't. But I feel like this is a bit more useful as far as general aesthetics and culture discussions is concerned. So I offered my Oscar-related thoughts, and hopefully somebody got something out of this. But anyway, I think that's about it for this video. If you like this video, I hope you'll consider liking some of my earlier videos, which are there just waiting for somebody to give them a chance. But anyway, that's all for now. Thanks for watching, and bye-bye.